Okay, so the next thing is what happens if you multiply? Okay, so if you multiply the product, f times g is defined, you just take the two functions and multiply them together. And the domain is the same thing. The domain of f times g is the intersection between the domain of f and the domain of g. So you just find the domain of each one, and if it's a restriction in one, it's going to be a restriction in the final. Okay, so you got a little bit more going on when you have multiplication. So let's see, let's let this dashed line be f of x and this solid line be g of x. And the first thing we want to do is write the domain. Okay, so we'll do that. Pretty easy domain, hopefully. This has domain all real numbers. That has domain all real numbers. There are no restrictions on the x coordinates. So the domain of f times g is negative infinity, infinity. Okay, because we're multiplying, that means that the quote-unquote degree, which you haven't learned yet, this is x to the 1 power, and a linear is x to the 1 power. When you multiply an x times an x, you know that's x squared. So when you start multiplying, the degree is going to change. And when the degree changes, the shape of the graph will change. Okay, so it's a little more complicated when you multiply. That's really all you need to know. So that's why we have a couple extra steps. So the first thing you want to do is you want to locate the zeros of the product. And the way you do that is you find the zeros of each function. So remember, zeros means x-intercepts. So the x-intercept for this f of x function is 4. And when x is 4, f is 0. Okay, the x-intercept for g is intersecting that x-axis at 2. And so when x is 2, g is 0. All right, let's figure out what, when x is 4, what's g? G is 1. When x is 2, what is f? F is, we'll say 0.5. And then if we multiply these zeros together, these y coordinates, 0 times 1 is 0, 0.5 times 0 is 0. So what do we learn there? We learn that the zeros of f and g are the zeros of the product. Okay, so we know that the result is going to go through 4 and 2. Now, why is that important? Well, the easiest way to graph these is to create these intervals. It says a sign chart can help organize when the graph is above or below the x-axis. Remember, positive numbers are above the x-axis and negative numbers are below. Okay, so what I'm doing is I took these zeros. There's a 0 at 2 and 4. And so I broke this x-axis into 3 pieces. Okay, this interval is negative infinity to 2. This interval is 2 to 4. And this interval is 4 to infinity. Alright, and now all I have to do is make a sign chart, which means I don't care about the actual numbers, I just care about the sign. So just concentrate on the f function, and in this region, see how this f of x is above the x-axis? That means all the y values are positive. And in this region, see how this f function is still above the x-axis? Okay, and then look at the f function here in this interval. See how they're below the x-axis, so that's a negative. Okay, let's look at g. Negative infinity to 2, g is below the x-axis. But 2 to 4, g is above, so that's a plus. And from 4 to infinity, it's also above, so that's a plus. Now, we're multiplying, right? So just multiply using your sign rules. What is a positive times a negative? A negative. What's a positive times a positive? It's a positive. What's a negative times a positive? It's a negative. So what that means is that this new function that we're creating, from negative infinity to 2, it's a negative. That means it's going to be below the x-axis. From 2 to 4, it's positive. That means it's going to be above the x-axis. And from 4 to infinity, it's a negative, so that means it's going to be below the x-axis. Okay, so if we graph, all we have to do is just sort of sketch that out. The zeros, this is where it's going to hit the x-axis, so we're going to start out below, but make sure we hit this here, and then between 2 and 4 it's above, and then from 4 to infinity it's below, and look what it turns out to be. It turns out to be a parabola. That means it's x squared. Here's the reason why. I don't want to figure out what these functions are, so I'm going to use different. So let's say I have the first one is negative x plus 2, and the second one is positive x minus 3. What's going to happen if you multiply those two together? So if we multiply k times h together, that's this. And we know how to multiply those together. You FOIL, that's going to be negative x squared plus 5x minus 6. I did that quickly in my head just because the main point is, look what happens when you multiply negative x to the first power times a positive x to the first power. You're going to get a negative x to the second power. Okay. So with a product, if the when you're multiplying the degrees, that means that they're going to change. So you started out with two lines, you ended up with a parabola because you end up with an x squared. So to make it easier on us, you don't need to know any of this. It's just I'm trying to link it. When it's a product, you want to find the zeros, and you want to make a sign chart. And then you want to use the negative, positive, negative to figure out what the graph is going to look like. Okay, so let's try this one. We have two lines, and we're going to let F be the dashed line and G be the solid line. And so again, we're trying to find the product. F times G, the domain, is going to be all real numbers because lines don't have any restrictions on their domain. And the zeros are, looks like, negative 1 and 3. And you can fill this out, but I know that those are going to be the zeros of the function. Okay, so then remember what we do here. We make a sign chart, and we're going to split this into three intervals. Okay, so this interval is negative infinity to negative 1. This interval here is negative 1 to 3. This interval here is 3 to infinity. And F is below the x-axis from negative infinity to negative 1. It's above the x-axis after that. G is below the x-axis from negative infinity to negative 1. It's also below the x-axis from negative 1 to 3, but it's above the x-axis there. Then you're finding the product. So a negative times a negative is a positive. Positive times a negative is a negative. Positive times a positive is a positive. So we're talking this graph is going to be above the x-axis, below the x-axis, above the x-axis. We know that these have these are the zeros of this product, so we know what's got to go through there. So we're going to be above, below, and then come back and be above, and there it is. All right, same thing. This time though, we have a parabola and a line, and we need to find its product. Again, the domain, there's no restrictions on a parabola. It goes on, x's are going to go on forever to the left, forever to the right. Same thing with a line, so that's your domain. We got to find the zeros since we're dealing with a product, and the f function does not cross the x-axis anywhere, and this line crosses the x-axis at zero, so that's the only zero I can see. All right, so this means that you're only going to have negative infinity to 0 and then 0 to infinity. And F is above the x-axis all the time. And G is below the x-axis to the left of 0 and above the x-axis to the right of 0. So then a positive times a negative is a negative, and a positive times a positive is a positive. So this means it's below the x-axis. This means it's above the x-axis. So we'll start out below. We know this is a zero, okay? And this is gonna be a strange one. I happen to know it's gonna look like that. Now, how would I know that? Well, it's because really our objective is to understand the symbolic goings on. So just for your curiosity, what's happening is f of x happens to be a quadratic, x squared plus 1 is the y-intercept. G of x is a line, it's our friend y equals x. Now what's going to happen when we multiply those together? So f times g of x, this is the main thing that you need to understand, how to do this. How to multiply two functions symbolically. Well, you just use your algebra rules and you're going to distribute that x and you're going to end up with x cubed plus x. That is your new function. And I happen to know what that looks like. That is a cubic function, and a cubic function has this little bend in it like that. Okay. So the idea is for you to understand using these graphic methods that really when you're adding, subtracting, or multiplying two functions together, you're creating a new function. All right, so we'll keep going. I'm gonna skip this one. I'll maybe show the answer at the end, but it's 37 minutes in, so I do wanna get to the U-try part where we're just not dealing with the graph anymore and we're just symbolically creating new functions. And these domains are a little harder. So I'm gonna pause and try them and then come back with me. Okay, so f of x is a radical function. Did you notice that it's gonna have a domain restriction? G of x is a rational function. It also is gonna have a domain restriction. So finding the domain of f plus g, f minus g, and f times g is the same. You want to find the domain of this one and this one, and then it's the intersection. So the domain of f, remember how you do it? You take what's under the radical and we memorize that what's under a radical, if it's even index, has to be greater than or equal to 0. So if I subtract 3, I get negative x is greater than or equal to negative 3. And then don't forget, I like to put a negative 1. When you divide by a negative number, you're going to switch that inequality. So the domain of f is that x has to be less than or equal to 3. All right, the domain of g, a little more complicated. It's a rational function, and we know that the denominator cannot equal 0. And so hopefully you remember that a quadratic, to solve a quadratic, you have to factor it. Now this, I didn't go over in the factoring video, but this is actually an easier one to factor. You don't need trial and error because it's called a difference of two squares. It's just going to factor into x plus 5, x minus 5. You can do it with trial and error, but you know that. And then 5, 25 is 1 and 25, or 5 and 5. And I've told you to do the ones that are close together. So if you've got a perfect square here, it's just going to be the same binomial except one's a plus and one's a minus. Anyway, then you set each of these equal, not equal to 0. And x cannot equal 5. So we're going to have quite a complicated domain here for these three. Because remember, all of these things have to be true. Okay, so I'm going to try to help you understand by just doing one number line. I'm going to put the key numbers in order. So negative 5 and then 3 and then 5. Okay. Always start with the not equal to's because they just show up as holes. So I'm going to put a hole here and a hole here. So I've taken care of that. Now what is x is less than or equal to 3? That has to be true. All the numbers have to be less than or equal to 3. So that would mean you would have a colored in circle at 3 and to the left, but remember it can't be negative 5, And this is the reason why you have to graph, because it turns out this isn't, this isn't needed. 5 isn't needed, can't be 5 isn't needed, because we know it has to be less than or equal to 3. So our domain of f plus g and f minus g and f times g, because it's always the intersection, is start left to right parentheses negative infinity to negative 5 parentheses union negative 5 to 3 bracket. Okay, now computing f plus g with an input x simply means add up the two functions. So f of x is the square root of 3 minus x, and g of x is 1 over x squared minus 25. And we're not in this class ready to add those up. Now, if you do an online source, it might simplify that, and I will be able to tell you used an online source, so don't do that. Just leave it that way. That's it. We're not solving for x. We're creating a weird, wacky function where if I were to graph that, it would look strange. Alright, f minus g would be the same thing, except a minus in the front, in the middle. Square root of 3 minus x minus 1 over x squared minus 25. C, f times g of x would be this function. Square root of 3 minus x times 1 over x squared minus 25. Now, I am going to do a little simplifying here because you should know this. How do you multiply these two together? Well, you can make anything a fraction. So the square root of 3 minus x is simply the square root of 3 minus x over 1. And multiplying fractions is easy. And when I say easy, I always think of things like easy, medium, hard. Not easy as in you should do it, be able to do it. Multiplying fractions, you don't have to get a common denominator. All you have to do is multiply straight across. So square root of 3 minus x times 1 is square root of 3 minus x. And 1 times x squared minus 25 is x squared minus 25. So that's worth simplifying. You end up with a rational function with a radical on the top. And you can see that this means that all the numbers have to be less than or equal to 3, but they can't be 5, but they can't be negative 5. So that domain checks out. Okay, and number 9, I went ahead and did it for you. What I did was I just went right across the x-axis and wrote down the zeros. And I didn't really bother with that because if it's a zero in either one of these, it's a zero in the product. So that's all I did. And I used those values to create these intervals. Left to right from negative infinity to negative 2, negative 2 to negative 1, negative 1 to 1, 1 to 2, and 2 to infinity. So those red lines kind of help you see the intervals. And then I looked at the dashed function and found out it's above, above, below, above, above. And then I looked at the g function and found out it was below, and then above, 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 and then below. And then I'm doing the product, so I used my sign rules and got negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. Now again, I'm not perfect, but I fixed it this time. I made a mistake here and had below, below, below. And I kind of had an idea that it should be alternating. Not always, but I knew what to look for, and so I was like, that doesn't look right to me. Let me double check. And sure enough, I had made a mistake, and I fixed it, and it ended up being below, above, below, above, below. So then I was ready to draw my function. I started below, went to that zero, then went above, went to that zero, went below, to that zero, went above, and then below. And I had an idea that that was going what I was going to get, because I have, just to do the symbolic stuff, I have a function f that's an x squared function and a function g that is an x squared function, and when I multiply, x squared times x squared is an x to the fourth function. Now this happens to be a negative x to the fourth, but I know the way an x to the fourth function can behave is it can look like that. So that's how I knew that.